Friends, welcome to this lecture on Models of Development Administration with a special reference to Inclusive Development. Introduction to the lesson. The concept of development and its variation in implementation have been the subject of discourse in public administration for over two decades. Development can be sustainable as well as inclusive. The first task is the definition of inclusive development, in particular, distinguishing it from growth, pro-poor growth and inclusive growth, and differentiating these from each other. Starting with growth, which has a tight and well-accepted definition as an increase in real per capita income, pro-poor growth is identified as that which also reduces income poverty. Inclusive growth is that which is accompanied by lower income inequality, so that the increment of income accrues disproportionately to those with lower incomes. With these definitions, growth can be pro-poor without being inclusive, since, as happened in many countries over the past two decades, growth can be accompanied by falling poverty but rising inequality. The concept of development differs from growth in expanding the focus from income alone to other dimensions of well-being, in particular, education and health. Inclusive development thus refers to the improvement of the distribution of well-being along with these dimensions. At the same time, as the average achievement improves, the Millennium Development Goals, MDGs, identify a number of these dimensions and provide a good framework for measuring and identifying inclusive development. The second issue is the relationship between rural infrastructure and inclusive development. Infrastructure for inclusive growth must therefore address its adequacy in rural areas, for example, rural roads connecting villages to each other and to small market towns, and these small market towns to district capital. Thus, rural infrastructure is also a determinant of inclusive development. Providing that utilization of infrastructure is given attention at the same time as its supply. What is inclusive development? In addressing the question of what is meant by inclusive development, two issues arise. First, the distinction between growth and development, and second, the importance of the term inclusive development brings into play dimensions of well-being beyond simply income. While inclusive focuses attention on the distribution of well-being in society, further intricacies arise, as will be seen, because the answers to these two questions are, in fact, interrelated. In principle, the distinction between growth and development should be clear at a general abstract level. Growth refers to economic growth, in other words, increase in per capita income. This is a narrowly defined technical concept that is measurable and is indeed measured by statistical agencies the world over. Development, on the other hand, is not at all well defined, at least not as precisely defined as growth. At different times, the term has been used to refer to, number one, just economic growth, number two, changes in economic structure of production, rising share of industry, and then services from an agricultural base. Number three, spatial distribution of population, that is increasing urbanization. Number four, improvements in social indicators of education and health, etc. The modernization debate in the social sciences has partly been about the normative significance of the trajectory of a country which might go through the above changes. It is a good thing, and should countries aim to go through this trajectory? Perhaps the best known example of the distinction between growth and development, certainly the best known in terms of indicators that are on par quantitatively with economic growth as an indicator, is the Human Development Index, HDI. As is well known, this index combines per capita income of a country with two other indicators to arrive at a single index of development. The two other indicators relate to education, measured by literacy rate, and health, measured by life expectancy. The objectives of those who formulated and developed the HDI included the explicit broadening of the evaluation of country performance from sole reliance on per capita income to other dimensions of human well-being. What is inclusive? Fairly clearly, it refers in some sense to the distribution of well-being, however, measured. A given average for a population can be distributed in an infinite number of ways, ranging from perfect equality to extreme equality. Let us then pursue the notion of inclusiveness as being captured in some sense by poverty. As for changes in average income, growth, its inclusiveness can thus be measured by the change in poverty. Specifically, we can calculate poverty change per unit of increase in per capita income, convert this into elasticity, and use this as a measure of the inclusiveness of growth. Such exercises are now common and yield useful insights into the nature of growth. Fairly clearly, a given increase in per capita income, given growth rate, it's consistent with a range of changes to poverty, including even an increase in poverty. This leads then to the idea of pro-poor growth, which at this level is indistinguishable from the inclusive growth. Both could be measured by the growth elasticity of poverty reduction. But consider now the behavior of the income distribution above the poverty line, and more generally, the inequality in the overall distribution as growth takes place. To summarize on income, therefore, the focus of policy for poverty reduction must be growth with as much inclusiveness as possible and with as much inclusiveness of the poorest as possible. Clearly, the same framework above that is now widely applied to income could in principle be applied to non-income dimensions of well-being. The same issues would arise along with this dimension of inclusiveness. there could be an improvement in the average level of literacy. With little or no improvement in literacy below the minimum cutoff on health, average life expectancy across all individuals could improve, but with little or no improvement below some acceptable minimum inequalities in health outcomes have become a matter of growing interest in developing and developed countries alike. Inclusive development occurs when average achievements improve and inequalities in these achievements fall. By analogy with the income case, we can define pro-poor development as occurring when improvements in average attainments are accompanied by improvements of achievements below a critical threshold. Thus, when development is inclusive, it is also pro-poor. But development can be pro-poor even though it is not inclusive. Inequality in this non-income dimension increases. Provided that this increase in inequality is not large enough to offset the impact on non-income poverty of the average improvement along with this dimension. The move from growth to inclusive growth takes only the first step, staying focused on the income dimension. The move from growth to development takes only the second step by bringing in non-income dimensions but staying focused on average achievements. Inclusive development as a concept invites and requires both steps to be taken. Is the Human Development Index, that is SDI, a measure of inclusive development? It brings in education and health alongside income in constructing an overall measure of well-being or performance for a country. However, it shows a concern for distribution only along one of these dimensions. This dimension is education because, as argued earlier, literacy measured as the achievement of minimum levels of reading and writing can be seen as being analogous to income poverty. It focuses attention on the lowest levels of educational achievement. But along the income dimension, the HDI uses only per capita income, not its distribution and not income poverty measures. Similarly, along the health dimension, the measure is average life expectancy, which can in principle improve while its distribution worsens. Thus, the HDI is not a measure of inclusive development. It should be noted, however, that there have been several attempts to modify the HDI to make it distributionally sensitive. Key indicators of the first goal, end poverty and hunger, to halve between 1990 and 2015, the proportion of people whose income is less than $1 per day, and to halve the proportion of people who suffer from hunger, focus on distribution as well as going beyond just income to bring in nutrition. The second goal, to achieve universal primary education, obviously goes beyond income but focuses attention on the lowest rung of educational achievement. The third, fourth, and fifth goals on gender equality, child health, and maternal health also emphasize distributional improvements of non-income dimensions. The sixth goal, combating HIV/AIDS, malaria, and other diseases, has as a target, for example, the achievement of universal access to treatment for HIV/AIDS to all those who need it. This is certainly a non-income goal, but what of its distributional characteristic? If we conceptualize HIV/AIDS on a continuum from worst to less bad, then universal access to treatment is like equalizing the shortfall of good health from the critical minimum. In this sense, it can be viewed as analogous to an income poverty target. But suppose HIV/AIDS afflicts primarily those who have higher incomes, then in addressing distribution among one dimension, we might give additional resources to those who are better off along another dimension. This raises the question of aggregation along different dimensions. The seventh MDG goal of environmental sustainability has several components, some of which are distributionally sensitive, but others of which are not. Thus, the sub-goal of halving the proportion of population without sustainable access to safe drinking water and basic sanitation is analogous to halving income poverty. As discussed above, pro-poor growth or inclusive growth, while still focuses on income, the concept of development introduces dimensions of well-being beyond income, but this raises the question of aggregating across these dimensions to arrive at a single measure of performance. What if income rises but health or education worsens? Even if all dimensions move in the same direction, if changes are at different rates in different countries for different dimensions, the evaluation question remains. The HDI resolves this in a particular way. It takes an equal weighted average of the indicators along the three dimensions of income, education and health. But it is not clear on what basis these weights, or indeed any other set of weights, can be chosen. The extensive debate on the question has not resolved the issue. Rural infrastructure and inclusive development. Investing in infrastructure, rural infrastructure in particular, is a policy instrument available to governments to advance their objectives. We focus on the differences with the objective of growth, which means paying attention to two issues: outcomes beyond income and distribution of these outcomes. As argued above, the MDGs provide a good way of implementing these concerns. Infrastructure is a broad term. The standard usage is, of course, in terms of roads, but electricity, telephone connections, water supply, buildings to house markets all fall into this category. The relationship between infrastructure and the levels and growth of income at the country level is much discussed in the literature. There could, in principle, be excessive investment in infrastructure with the growth objective, in the sense that the economic rate of return from the investment is below the opportunity cost of funds. But a significant body of literature argues that the issue in most developing countries is too little infrastructure to support rapid growth. The most obvious case is road connections between production centers, whether manufacturing or natural resource extraction, and points of export. Thus, for example, it is argued that one of the reasons why structural adjustment did not have as much success as expected in Africa was because of the poor state of infrastructure. Getting the prices right to incentivize agricultural production for export was not of much use if the produce could not be got to the port in time and in good condition. But cuts in public expenditure and especially in public investment worsened an already bad situation and negated the pricing reforms. Internal divergence between rural and urban areas, between coastal and inland areas, and between subnational regions more generally, which tracks unequal development of infrastructure across these divides, has become a worrying aspect of recent growth experience. The objective of inclusive development, improving well-being of the worst off along non-income dimensions such as education and health, strengthens the case for rural roads even more. While income growth is one determinant of improvements in education and health, it is not the only one, and there is considerable variation in these achievements at any level of income. Direct intervention along these dimensions to improve the lowest achievements is what we are led to if we accept the objective of inclusive development. And rural roads are central to improving these achievements. There is now considerable evidence that transportation is strongly complementary to health and education achievements. Clearly, having good antenatal care, good facilities for delivery, and good immediate postnatal care are central to lowering maternal mortality. But in many cases, maternal mortality turns out to be a transportation problem. When complications set in during home delivery, there is a relatively short time window during which the woman needs to be taken to appropriate hospital facilities. There are then two issues. Whether there is a facility nearby, say in the small market town nearest to the village or in the district capital, and how quickly the woman can be got to the facility. The quality of roads and the quality of transportation facilities turns out to be critical. Despite some powerful views to the contrary, growth has been supplemented by inclusive development as the objective of policy and of development assistance. Growth is precise as a concept. Inclusive development is not. But the MDGs provide a useful framework for specific discussions, with the added bonus that there is greater international consensus on these as objectives than on growth alone. Given that rural areas lag in their MDG achievements and that infrastructure is casually linked to improvements in these achievements, investment in rural infrastructure emerges as a key intervention in support of inclusive development. Model questions. Question number one. Explain the important characteristics of inclusive development. Number two. Is Human Development Index, HDI, a measurement of inclusive development? Give reasons for your argument. Is the Human Development Index, that is HDI, a measure of inclusive development? It brings in education and health alongside income in constructing an overall measure of well-being or performance for a country. However, it shows a concern for distribution only along one of these dimensions. This dimension is education, because as argued earlier, literacy, measured as the achievement of minimum levels of reading and writing, can be seen as being analogous to income, poverty. It focuses attention on the lowest levels of educational achievement. But along the income dimension, the HDI uses only per capita income, not its distribution, and not income poverty measures. Similarly, along the health dimension, the measure is average life expectancy, which can in principle improve, while its distribution worsens. Thus, the HDI is not a measure of inclusive development. It should be noted, however, that there have been several attempts to modify the HDI to make it distributionally sensitive. Key indicators of the first goal, end poverty and hunger, to half between 1990 and 2015, the proportion of people whose income is less than $1 per day, and to half the proportion of people who suffer from hunger, focus on distribution as well as going beyond just income to bring in nutrition. The second goal, to achieve universal primary education, obviously goes beyond income but focuses attention on the lowest rung of educational achievement. The third, fourth, and fifth goals on gender equality, child health, and maternal health also emphasize distributional improvements of non-income dimensions. The sixth goal, combating HIV/AIDS, malaria, and other diseases, has as a target, for example, the achievement of universal access to treatment for HIV/AIDS to all those who need it. This is certainly a non-income goal, but what of its distributional characteristic? If we conceptualize HIV/AIDS on a continuum from worst to less bad, then universal access to treatment is like equalizing the shortfall of good health from the critical minimum. In this sense, it can be viewed as analogous to an income poverty target. But suppose HIV/AIDS afflicts primarily those who have higher incomes, then in addressing distribution among one dimension, we might give additional resources to those who are better off along another dimension. This raises the question of aggregation along different dimensions. The 7th MDG goal of environmental sustainability has several components, some of which are distributionally sensitive, but others of which are not. Thus, the sub-goal of halving the proportion of population without sustainable access to safe drinking water and basic sanitation is analogous to halving income poverty. As discussed above, pro-poor growth or inclusive growth, while still focuses on income, the concept of development introduces dimensions of well-being beyond income. But this raises the question of aggregating across these dimensions to arrive at a single measure of performance. What if income rises but health or education worsens? Even if all dimensions move in the same direction, if changes are at different rates in different countries for different dimensions, the evaluation question remains. The HDI resolves this in a particular way. It takes an equal weighted average of the indicators along the three dimensions of income, education and health. But it is not clear on what basis these weights, or indeed any other set of weights, can be chosen. The extensive debate on the question has not resolved the issue. Rural infrastructure and inclusive development. Investing in infrastructure, rural infrastructure in particular, is a policy instrument available to governments to advance their objectives. We focus on the differences with the objective of growth, which means paying attention to two issues: outcomes beyond income and distribution of these outcomes. As argued above, the MDGs provide a good way of implementing these concerns. Infrastructure is a broad term. The standard usage is, of course, in terms of roads, but electricity, telephone connections, water supply, buildings to house markets all fall into this category. The relationship between infrastructure and the levels and growth of income at the country level is much discussed in the literature. There could, in principle, be excessive investment in infrastructure with the growth objective, in the sense that the economic rate of return from the investment is below the opportunity cost of funds. But a significant body of literature argues that the issue in most developing countries is too little infrastructure to support rapid growth. The most obvious case is road connections between production centers, whether manufacturing or natural resource extraction, and points of export. Thus, for example, it is argued that one of the reasons why structural adjustment did not have as much success as expected in Africa was because of the poor state of infrastructure. Getting the prices right to incentivize agricultural production for export was not of much use if the produce could not be got to the port in time and in good condition. But cuts in public expenditure and especially in public investment worsened an already bad situation and negated the pricing reforms. Internal divergence between rural and urban areas, between coastal and inland areas, and between subnational regions more generally, which tracks unequal development of infrastructure across these divides, has become a worrying aspect of recent growth experience. The objective of inclusive development, improving well-being of the worst off along non-income dimensions such as education and health, strengthens the case for rural roads even more. While income growth is one determinant of improvements in education and health, it is not the only one, and there is considerable variation in these achievements at any level of income. Direct intervention along these dimensions to improve the lowest achievements is what we are led to if we accept the objective of inclusive development. And rural roads are central to improving these achievements. There is now considerable evidence that transportation is strongly complementary to health and education achievements. Clearly, having good antenatal care, good facilities for delivery, and good immediate postnatal care are central to lowering maternal mortality. But in many cases, maternal mortality turns out to be a transportation problem. When complications set in during home delivery, there is a relatively short time window during which the woman needs to be taken to appropriate hospital facilities. There are then two issues. Whether there is a facility nearby, say in the small market town nearest to the village or in the district capital, and how quickly the woman can be got to the facility. The quality of roads and the quality of transportation facilities turns out to be critical. Despite some powerful views to the contrary, growth has been supplemented by inclusive development as the objective of policy and of development assistance. Growth is precise as a concept. Inclusive development is not. But the MDGs provide a useful framework for specific discussions, with the added bonus that there is greater international consensus on these as objectives than on growth alone. Given that rural areas lag in their MDG achievements and that infrastructure is casually linked to improvements in these achievements, investment in rural infrastructure emerges as a key intervention in support of inclusive development. Model questions. Question number one. Explain the important characteristics of inclusive development. Number two. Is Human Development Index, HDI, a measurement of inclusive development? Give reasons for your argument.